The revolution will not be televised. The revolution is here.
What's up? Y'all here in Stanford, Connecticut, waiting for my connecting train up to New Haven. You know what I'm saying? Day's looking beautiful, so I'm feeling good about what's about to go down in about 3.5-4 hours. Master's T, I'm excited. Got a good message for you guys out of Yale. You know what I'm saying? Dangerous Negro will be in the building. Is unseen or heard. A king with words can't knock the hustle, but I've seen street dreams deferred. Dark spots in my mind where the scene occurred. Some say I'm too deep, I'm in too deep to sleep. Through me, Muhammad will forever speak. Greet brothers with handshakes on ghetto landscapes. What's up, people? Yeah, they just showed me up here to the master suite. You know what I'm saying? This is where all the celebrities stay at. You know, the guest speakers when they come to Yale University. This is where they stay. So, you know, it's pretty cool. They got some nice artwork in here, everything the common person could want, except for television, but I don't watch television because I don't have time to waste, but check it out.
I'm the Associate Master of Formal College, and it's a real pleasure today to have Demetrius Walker with us, who, among a number of other things that I assume you'll hear about, is the Chief Marketing Officer for Dangerous Negro Clothing Company. But the reason he's here is courtesy of Jeremy Harp, who is a junior political science major in Chrome. And I'd actually like to have Jeremy introduce
Demetrius. He's a motivational speaker, a world traveler. He's been on radio talk shows around the country. He's, like Andrew said, the Chief Marketing Officer for the Dangerous Negro clothing line. This would be very, very interesting. I can't wait to hear what Mr. Walker has to say.
You know, didn't know where I fit in the world, what I was supposed to be doing. And I had a couple of offers on the table, but, you know, nothing I was thrilled about, to be honest. And then I walked outside, I looked at my car. You know, I had a hoopty in undergrad. It was pretty beat down. Paint was chipping off of it, and I made a decision. I said, you know, I'm way too handsome to be driving this. And so, yeah, I had a car, but I felt like I was too handsome to be in the hoopty, so I made a decision on the spot. I said, I'm going to go with the employer that has the most income potential. I'm going to work my heart out until I get rich. And so I took a job with the world's largest computer maker out of undergrad. And I would say the name, but I know you guys like to post these things on YouTube, so I don't want them to blow up my house while I'm gone. So we'll keep it at the world's largest computer maker. And, you know, I put in a lot of work. I was doing 10, 11, 12 hours a day, 6 days a week. You know, I completely revamped my life. I stopped volunteering with the kids I mentored in undergrad. I stopped going to church. I stopped hanging out with my friends. I pretty much just went to work and looked forward to my community.
Things started to change.
We saw an unexpected rally from our rival, HP, about halfway through my stint at the world's largest computer maker. And everything started to change. I mean, number one, my commission checks started to shrink a little bit. Started getting micromanaged more. Management was constantly down my back.
At this point,
I had to reassess my life. Reached out to some of my friends that I had been neglecting. There wasn't any Malcolm X for our generation, any Martin Luther King for our generation. It was very disappointing to us. But at the same time, you know, people like myself who went off to corporate America and completely forgot about everybody, we weren't contributing to the solution, we were contributing to the problem. It was actually William C. Sullivan. He was the head of the FBI's Domestic Intelligence Division. He wrote a letter to J. Edgar Hoover, who had it out for Dr. King. And in his letter, he said, after yesterday's demagogic speech by Dr. King, there's no question that he stands head and shoulders above all of the Negroes combined. And we must mark him now, if we have not done so before, as the most dangerous Negro leader to the cause of communism, the Negro, and national security. Mm-hmm. And this is how they identified Dr. Martin Luther King. Mm-hmm. So when we went back and looked at the people that we saw the youth objectifying as, you know, dangerous, or the thugs, you know, the drug dealers, the pimps, the hustlers that we saw on TV, we were like, those aren't the dangerous Negroes. Mm-hmm. The dangerous Negroes are the people like King and like A. Philip Randolph, and that's who we need to emulate. And so that's why we chose the name Dangerous Negro. Whatever you're passionate about, do it. Don't get boxed into just being or becoming a corporate robot. You know, whatever you're talented in, whatever your gift is for the world, don't just allow yourself to sit in a box and not use it. You know, whatever it may be talking to people, it may be singing, whatever it might be, you know, make sure you have some type of outlet to contribute that to the world. You know, some questions you need to ask yourself, do you know what it is that you can contribute to the world? That's the hardest one. You know, a lot of people don't figure that out until later on in life. But start asking yourself what it is that you do better than other people, or that you're passionate about, or more passionate about than other people are.
What do you think happens in formalized education, mm-hmm. especially in places like Yale, where you have some of the brightest young people in the world? Mm-hmm. What does Yale do to them to defeat their entrepreneurism?
Well, I think the reason is fear. Fear is the number one reason. Fear and greed. I mean, that was one of my main reasons for doing what I did. I wanted to make money. You know, I didn't want to have to worry about coming up with some type of marketing strategy to start from scratch. You know, this company's already making money. If I work with them and give them my blood, sweat, and tears for, you know, 20, 30, 40 years, I'll retire and eventually maybe get to spend it and enjoy it. What you do, you wear your Dangerous Negro shirt, and you know, they say they do a random search.
Yeah.
It's always funny how you end up being a random search, you know, with a Dangerous Negro shirt. And actually, I wasn't a random search this time. When I came through LaGuardia, I mean, when I was coming through Houston to get here, this guy in front of me ended up being a random search. And he's like, this guy got a Dangerous Negro shirt on. It's always fun.
And we're at a school where most of the faculty is white, right. But we have a significant number of kids of color and international students. Mm-hmm. If you could make a change in high schools, like mandate every high school has to have, or you know what I mean, something like that. What? Because I see a lot of kids who need something that isn't there. But it's hard for me to know what it is, and it's sometimes hard for them to know quite what it is. But there's something which is not there. Whether it's role models, or it's kind of different ways of working, mm-hmm. or it's being allowed to wear the clothes that you feel comfortable in. Or you know what I mean? Is there something that you've kind of?
Well, obviously you can't say we're going to mix up the whole school, and now you have to have 6 transgender kids in every class and 4 African Americans. I mean, that's impossible.
Right.
But just opening them up to diversity, letting them know from the beginning, you know, these type of people are out here. Here's one. We're going to bring them in to introduce you to them. Let them know about that experience so that people form opinions about people they've never met, mm-hmm. you know, which is what's unfortunate.
I'd like for you to speak on how the youth have received your clothing line, and do you see people changing, or have you seen or heard stories of people saying, I was inspired by your message, and things like that?
Well, yeah, the youth, I mean, they love it, man. The kids, sometimes, actually, it's more so the parents who are hesitant to allow their kids to wear our brand, because obviously the parents coming up in certain eras, the word Negro means different things mm-hmm. to certain people. And they say, Dangerous Negro, oh, no, I can't let you wear that. And then we get emails all the time from kids that are like, yeah, you know, I had this argument with my mom and I finally won because Dangerous Negro is a good thing, and you know, you guys are doing this and this. So, you know, we get that kind of message all the time.